to introduce Stefan Grzeszkinski, newly arrived at the Augsburg University, and he will speak today about the Feynman-Katz particle models for cloning algorithms. Thank you, Stefan, for accepting our invitation.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks a lot. Thank you for the invitation. I'm really happy to present some results here. So I'm going to talk about particle models to approximate cloning algorithms. And this is a joint work with three people. Letizia Angeli was a PhD student in Warwick. At the time, we did most of the research. Now she moves on to Edinburgh as a postdoc. Adam Johansson is a statistician in Warwick who knew about the stats part of the project. And Andrea Pizzoferrato, a postdoc at the Turing Institute, who did some simulation work related to that. And so let me give a short outline. So I'm going to give some motivation from essentially the statistical physics models that most of the audience will know about, but just very quickly. And then to introduce a problem, and then some connection to sequential Monte Carlo methods for continuous time jump processes, which is the main theoretical part. And then I will apply this theory to the cloning algorithm, which has been kind of introduced by theoretical physicists in 2006, I think. Okay. And at the very end, there won't be enough time for everything, but I think I can come back to have a concrete example of current fluctuations in an interacting particle systems. Okay. So the motivation comes from very common systems that most of us know about. So this is the totally asymmetric simple exclusion process in on a one-dimensional lattice. Particles jump to the right with rate one if the site in front of them is empty, otherwise they are not allowed to jump. And then, of course, on the macroscopic scale, you will be able to count a particle current that crosses a certain bond here when you put a measurement device here. And if the density of particles is zero, then there's no particle crossing. And if the density is one, then all the particles are blocked and there's no crossing either. So you have the current as a function of the density has zero in these two endpoints, and then it is it's a symmetric function. It's simply given by rho times one minus rho for this model where it has a maximum current at density 1/2. And so this is a typical count if you run a simulation of this model, or you run the process for a large, say, lattice size, say periodic boundary conditions, just to fix the idea for now. And then you're interested in trying to find out what happens how do atypical currents in the system appear? Okay. So the typical trajectories look like this. So if you follow one particular particle, this is space and this is time going up, just moves to the right in this step fashion. And if you want to condition your system on an atypical current, then you have two ways to do that. So you can either be larger than a typical current. So everything I'm plotting here is at these trajectories at density 1/2, right? So I have typically a current of 1/4, and then I'm conditioning on seeing something larger than that, like 1/3 or so. And then the system has to somehow ask the question, how does the system realize such a large current over an extended period of time? And this, to do that, the particles have to actually work together and move in parallel much more than independently to achieve a larger current, because if you have current hole configurations, they can kind of jump more efficiently than if they are randomly distributed. Okay, so this is one strategy to realize this, and it turns out that if for larger currents in this particular model, this is the most likely scenario you will see if you observe an atypical large current. If you observe a small current, you typically see a different scenario, because here, so we are still at density 1/2, we want to see a smaller current, say 0.1, then the system typically phase separates into a low density region. So if you fix a particular time here and go across space, and a high density region, and these regions, they behave like traveling waves. So they move to the right here in this particular example. And you can essentially from the current density plot, you can read off what pairs work to fix the total density in your system, that is 1/2, right? So I have a high density and low density region. I have to, in total, it has to be 1/2. And I want to fix a total current in the system. So this is going to be given by any pairs of points where the connecting line goes through this point. The red point is the one you want to condition on. Oh, sorry, I'm going back. Okay. So, and then of course you have many, many pairs of points on blue pairs of points on this J of rho function, and you have to pick the most optimal in the sense that it's the most likely to be realized. And for this particular model, there's a very nice theory by Jensen and Varadhan who actually connect this to the entropy production of the essentially the associating PDE for this model. So you can think of these profiles as solutions, as non-entropic solutions to the PDE, and then you have to stabilize a non-entropic shock that will cost some entropy, and the cost of this entropy is exactly how unlikely it is to see this to see this large deviation. Okay,
these simulations. Yeah. If I can ask you.
Yeah.
So how do you obtain these simulations? And the first one.
I stole this from Giardina, and the point is, so you use the cloning algorithm. So this is essentially you bias the sampling of your process in a very particular way, and then you can see atypical trajectories. Okay, and this is exactly what I'm going to talk about. So how do you do this, right? I'm not going to talk about the theory of this. There are some theoretical results for some models, fully rigorous, and a lot also for weakly asymmetric models in a similar fashion. But I'm really going to talk about how can you numerically approach such a question, and also in particular simulate the process that shows large deviation behavior. Okay, so this was just essentially the introduction for that. So this is, by the way, this is a discrete time simulation at this time, but one year later they did a continuous time version of the same algorithm essentially. Good. And the main principle simply is essentially so has been introduced in the sequential Monte Carlo literature quite a bit earlier. I mean, so in 2006, the theoretical physicists started doing this for interacting particle systems, which we are familiar with. But the idea was very similar, in fact, can be connected to ideas from particle filters of sequential Monte Carlo methods. So this is usually done in discrete time. So I have a discrete time sketch here, how this works. These are all evolutionary type algorithms. So you run many copies of the process you're interested in, you say, for a certain amount of time. So in discrete time is one time step. Then you reweight the ensemble here. So you give different weights to different realizations, depending on how well they behave in terms of the conditioning you are looking after. Then you resample from the empirical distribution of this weighted ensemble, and you run again. Okay, you can also do some perturbation here. This is not so important, just to avoid degeneracies. Okay, so this is a kind of idea that is behind these particle filters in discrete time, and you can also do this essentially in continuous time in the background. You do a certain weighting procedure all the time, and then you have certain trajectories you copy because they have a high score in your weighting scheme, and others you kill. Okay, and I'm going to explain how this works. And how you can essentially describe it with this theory of particle filters that was essentially developed by Del Moral and Miklo. Okay, so now the mathematical setting. So we are interested, so we will focus on continuous time processes, but also jump processes. Okay, so they are, because these are the most interesting class somehow to study these interacting particle systems. So we need some conditions here on the state space. So this should be locally compact Polish space. So we can treat spin systems or like bounded local state space particle systems on infinite lattices, or if we have unbounded local state space, we can treat finite lattice particle systems. Just a side remark. So so the dynamics will be given by a transition kernel. And we want to have a uniformly bounded total rate of this transition kernel. So this is a total exit rate out of state X. And then obviously the dynamics is given by this generator that we can, because of this condition, we can define this for all bounded continuous functions. Okay, so then the distribution of this process simply evolves with the Dynkin equation. So the expectation of a test function F at time t is essentially time derivative is given by the generator. And we need one very important property of the system, which is asymptotic stability. So there has to be a unique stationary distribution for this process, mu infinity, and you have to converge exponentially fast to this stationary distribution, essentially. This is, of course, when you have a finite state Markov chain, you think of this tape on a finite lattice, you have a spectral gap, and then you automatically have this property Fuchs-Zieler. Okay, but we also want to include some jump processes that are on continuous domains a priori. So this is why we write this in a more general way here. Okay, so this is the main setting the type of process we can deal with. Now, in order to bias the same what this process does, so you don't want to follow the typical behavior of this, you have to perturb the generator. And to do this, you add a diagonal part to the generator here, which I call this a potential V of X. Okay, this is also a bounding continuous function. And then you can study the time evolution under this new operator that has the generator plus a diagonal part. So this simply you have the same time evolution equation. And then you know by Feynman-Katz formula that this nu t is essentially, you can represent it like this. So it's the expectation of a test function under the original process weighted with this exponential factor, right? So that's clear. And the point is now, obviously, that this new generator LV, the perturbed one, is not conservative. So if we plug in a constant function, we don't get zero. We get V of X, easy to see from here. And also from a generalized version of the Perron-Frobenius theory, essentially, you get that you have a print this perturbed generator has a principal eigenvalue, which is real, and also has a left eigenvector associated to it that we essentially inherit from this assumption of asymptotic stability that we made on the original process. Okay, and this principal eigenvalue is really the object of interest for most of what the physicists were looking after when they want to apply this theory. Okay, so. And this can be essentially, this is characterizing also the asymptotic decay rate or explosion rate of the probability of the measure nu t, which is not, this doesn't conserve probability, right? So this is either, this is behaves exponentially, asymptotically with lambda. And you can also see from when you apply L to the constant function, you get V. So you can characterize lambda also as the stationary, well, it's not a stationary measure. It's just a left eigenvector for now. You can normalize this guy to be a probability measure, right? So because it has it doesn't have different science entries. You know that too, and then you can normalize it to be a probability distribution, and then this would be an expectation of the function V according to this measure. And essentially what you want to do now is, okay, you want a numerical procedure, so you want to do some Monte Carlo, have a process that converges to this, that has this as a stationary distribution, and then you can do classical Monte Carlo sampling to estimate expectations with respect to mu infinity V, in particular of if expectation of V itself, which was what the physicists are interested in, but you can do any other thing as well, so general test function. Okay, so that's the goal now. So problem with these new T's is they are not even normalized measures. So first thing is you normalize the time evolution under this for this unnormalized measures new T, right? Easiest thing, you just divide by the normalization. Okay. Call this mu T. Should be called mu T V, but I want to avoid the superscript V everywhere. So everything depends on V now somehow from now on. And this is at least for every fixed T, this is a probability distribution mu T. And you can easily, of course, get the time evolution of expectations under this probability distributions from doing whatever. You know the time derivative of this guy, and then you do a product rule, okay? And the point is, because of this nonlinearity here with this 1 over nu t1, you get a nonlinear evolution equation for mu t. So mu t shows up here and here. So it's a quadratic equation, right? It's not no longer linear in mu t. Good, but still, what we also have is, again, from asymptotic stability of the original process, that these mu t's will converge exponentially to the right stationary distribution mu infinity that we're interested in sampling from, okay? So we can use these mu t's, at least it's a sequence of probability measures we have now. Still, what we do not have is a process that has these guys as marginals, right? So we want to actually simulate a process. So that's the next step. How do you get a process that has distribution mu t at time t? So, okay, let's look again at the evolution equation of this mu t. So if it is of the form mu t of some operator on f, then it's fine. Then it's operator, you can say this is a generator if it has the right properties. And you can use this as a process, okay? So if v is zero, obviously we have the original process. So, but now we have this thing here is perturbed. So we want to, by force, simply write this in the form of a generator. So this nonlinear part here that comes from non-zero potentials on the diagonal, we want to write this as a generator acting on f, okay? Obviously this generator now has to depend on mu t itself. So it's going to be a nonlinear process. And there's actually quite a few processes. So this goes under the name in this statistics literature under the name McKean realization or McKean processes that fulfill this condition. So you have quite some choice here how to find a process that has mu t as time marginals. So, and the general condition is obviously so this L tilde part here, the second part of the generator, we want to also again think of this should be a chump process again on our state space. And we get in the, so this is an ansatz, right? So we want to have a jump rate kernel, a jump rate density here in Y, and then integrate with respect to mu to get this nonlinearity. Okay, so this is our ansatz for this generator of the extra dynamics that we get here. And so this has to hold for every mu. It's a family in index with a measure mu, right? And then the consistency condition is exactly, so if I take the integral over mu of this object, I should get this part essentially, right? Okay, then I have, if this is true, then a process with a generator will fulfill this equation. Good. So this is the consistency equation we have to fulfill. And you can show that, I mean, so that this holds, in particular, if you pick your new rates in a proper way. So how does this look? So the difference of these rates, so jumping into state X minus jumping out of state X is given essentially by this potential V, okay? So you can think of V as kind of a fitness thing. The higher V, the better the state, okay, somehow. So this is, we call this a fitness potential already in this evolutionary interpretation here, okay? And you, okay, this is normalized with respect to the average fitness of the process under measure mu. Okay, this is if and only if, but you can make this a bit weaker. You can a sufficient condition is if this is true for every point y. Okay, before this was an integral condition with a mu in here. So to make it more explicit, you say okay, if this holds for every y, then definitely I have this condition fulfilled. And then you can already see, so it's a bit more explicit now. You jump from y into x with a potential difference essentially. Okay, so. And this is the exact condition how it has to look. And then it's easy to see that there's some very simple choices fulfill this equation. For example, you could choose the jump rate. So this is the first choice that the people use essentially for the cloning algorithm. This is the choice that is used. So you can pick any constant C and simply, so the rate to move from X to Y gets higher the less fit you are in state X. So if you're currently in X, you move out with a higher rate if you are less fit than the level C, okay? Because this is a negative part of this difference. Okay, so that's some positive number, but the negative part. And this is a positive part of this difference. So the higher the fitness of your target state Y, the higher the rate to move there, okay? Always compared to some level C. You can put C equal to zero, or you can be clever. If a good choice would be to pick C to the average fitness in your current process, so to adapt this in time, okay? This can be time dependent, but it cannot depend on X or Y. Okay, good. So this is kind of, here we see also this interpretation, evolutionary interpretation with V a potential, fitness potential. And then there's a more efficient choice that is not working for the cloning algorithm, but this is what this the stats people use a lot, is simply, okay, so the rate to move from X to Y is simply given by the positive part of this potential difference, okay? So you, in a sense, you want to, you try to minimize this part of the dynamics because this is kind of, ideally you want to run your original dynamics and simply see the right thing, but then you have to perturb it, and the more you perturb it with higher additional rates, the higher will be the variance of your sampler in the end. So you, this is really a thing you want to minimize. So the smaller the total, this part of the dynamics you can make it, the better. Okay. So this is why you already at this stage, it's good to think a little bit about how you can make this most efficient. So here you definitely only go from less fit to fitter states. Here can something else can happen as well if you're unlucky. So you, okay. So sorry, this I only mentioned this. This is the most efficient thing that people use. It's called related to remainder resampling in discrete time works really well. This is a continuous time version of that. But to implement that is in a practical setting is very challenging because you always have, I mean, you see, these are very simple, essentially linear functions. And then if you want to really run a simulation with it, you can implement this very efficiently with some rejection-based algorithm or whatever, right? So this is always the price you have to pay. You add additional dynamics to your process and you have to actually simulate them. If they become too complicated to simulate them in efficiently, like this guy does for the models, at least we looked at, and then they also, this is also a problem that you run into, even though this would be more efficient on a theoretical basis. Okay, but I'm talking too much ahead because we don't know yet why efficiency, whatever. So there's at least these two choices are interesting for us to carry on later. Now we have a process, a nonlinear Markov process that has the right stationary distribution, and we can use this to do Markov chain Monte Carlo to sample from this mu infinity. And okay, but the problem is this is a nonlinear process. So how do you but this is standard. How do you simulate nonlinear processes where you need to know the distribution at time t? You replace this distribution at time t with the empirical distribution, and you run a lot of copies of your process in parallel. Okay, then you can approximate the distribution at time t by the empirical distribution of all the copies, and that way you turn this nonlinear process into a linear standard Markov process on a higher dimensional state space. Okay, and I call M now simply then the fixed number of copies that you run in parallel, and this is a generic notation for the empirical measure. I may come back later. Okay, and the empirical measure of the process itself. If I plug in the state of the process at time t, and this is a shorthand, so we call it mu t. Okay, so and now what are now simple choices of these so-called mean field approximations where you can show that they actually, when you send M to infinity, what you simulate converges to this nonlinear one particle nonlinear process, right? So that's what you have to show. So as always, this single particle process is given by this McKean model, right? So we have a original generator and this nonlinear part. So the whole thing has a generator that is a nonlinear process with a generator L mu. So, and now what you simply do in the simplest possible particle approximation is called mean field approximation. You simply replace this mu distribution at time t with the empirical distribution, and you act independently with this new generator on all the copies of the process. Okay, so this Li acts only on copy I. So it does whatever this guy did to copy I, modulo mu being replaced by M. And because you replace this by M, this is also introducing a kind of mean field interaction between the copies, right? This guy only acts on copy I, but the parameter depends on the other copies via the empirical measure. Okay, so this is called a mean field approximation. And then obviously you have to check certain things to be able to show that they converge. Some things better be true. For example, if you look at test functions f for this process now, which has m copies of the, so the points are now m dimensional vectors, you only observe one copy in single particle test functions, so say, then obviously this generator here should be the single particle generator acting on the function f of xi. So you generate the right single particle dynamics, which is obvious from this choice, right? But this is a general feature that you want to have for other particle approximations as well. And then by linearity of the generator, if you have this property, you automatically get a mean field test function, which is a much more interesting test function, because if you really want to measure something from this particle system now, you don't want to throw away all the copies. You want to use all your copies, right? So typically, if you want to measure a function little f, you take the empirical average over all the copies as your big test function capital F, right? So that's a good, and this is, you can write this as an empirical average of the small f, and then so just by linearity, I mean obviously the dynamics of this mean field type test functions is given by the empirical average of the single particle dynamics. Again, this is a, the right consistency thing. Okay, this is easy to see for this mean field, but we want to generalize this later to another system. So that's why I wrote it down. And this mean field dynamics, if you want to illustrate this in a little picture. So you, for example, so this was the original dynamics of our process where we didn't perturb the generator. Okay, so these were this kernel W. So in this evolutionary interpretation, we call this simply the mutation dynamics. Okay, so this is the original dynamic. So this is all the clones. If you only had the blue dots, they would evolve independently, simply the original process that you were trying to, that you started out with. Okay, and then you introduce this this sampling by additional selection dynamics. Okay, which here come for this particular choice of the rates. I have to go back for this. Sorry. I'm talking about this choice now. So you have these additional selection rates that come in two parts, okay? And you can, both of them have a slightly different interpretation here. Yeah? So the first one is the red one. So this is new dynamics in order to bias our process in the right way. It's called cloning. So with this rate, okay, what you do, so if your fitness is higher than some level C, then you get cloned with this rate. And what does it mean? You uniformly pick a target site J. You kill this guy and copy yourself into J. Okay, this is a cloning event. Okay, so you kind of you reward the good ones, so to say. And then if your fitness is not good, so you're smaller than C, this negative part here, then what happens? You get killed and replaced by a uniform. By a copy of another clone, which is uniformly chosen again. So this uniform choice comes from this 1 over m here. Okay, and this is, I mean, this is simply written down. This if you just write this out, everything you use this mean field approximation with these rates that I showed you before. This simply comes out. Okay, so you have this more explicit interpretation of the two parts of these dynamics. Okay. When you look at this picture, I hope this is a little bit became clear a little bit. Okay. So certain guys are killed. If you're less fit, then see you're killed. If you're fitter, you're cloned. Okay, and one clone at a time, right? That's how it comes out in this mean field model. Okay, good. So now how do you just some standard stochastic analysis simply to fix the ideas how you describe the how you show that this thing converges in the limit m to infinity. Okay, so. Obviously, so we write down simply the difference of the integral of the generator of the process with the test function at time t is going to be a martingale, and we have a predictable an explicit formula for the predictable quadratic variation of this martingale given by the integral of the Carré-Duchamp operator. Okay, so you have to essentially if you want to show a law of large number property of this process, if I send m to infinity, the randomness that comes from this clone from this particle approximation should concentrate, and I should simulate the evolution equation mu for mu tf, right? That's what I'm interested in. Okay, I want to sample mu tf, and this is I'm looking for a law of large number type result, and so I need a concentration property. So and you get this from studying the Carré-Duchamp, which essentially quantifies the fluctuations of this process, and this should go to zero in some sense, and you can see in the, again for this mean field model, it's relatively easy to see that. So you have to now see how does the Carré-Duchamp act on test functions. Again, first exercise is to look single particle test function. Then you can easily see, okay, the Carré-Duchamp of this mean field approximation is the Carré-Duchamp of the single particle process acting on F. So this works, but obviously Carré-Duchamp is not a linear operator anymore. So you have to do this is. You really have to do a computation here, but it's a standard computation in the mean field case, and you see that because essentially when you do this Carré-Duchamp computations, the off-diagonal contributions can often cancel out, and it's a standard thing that you get a factor of 1 over m in front here, because I'm looking at a test function that essentially is given by 1 over m sum of test functions, right? So that's a standard thing. So if you do propagation of chaos type results. So, and that's very good, of course, because you have this 1 over m, you make m bigger, then if you look at mean field observables of your clone ensemble, then they're going to, the evolution of these is going to concentrate. Okay, and now we want to, so for the mean field model, you can show this with these elementary things. Now we want to generalize a little bit to include the cloning algorithm in our set of dynamics that we can describe, okay? Because the cloning algorithm is different, it's not a mean field thing. I'll explain it in a second, they still haven't introduced, but first let me give a set of general assumptions that we can generalize this now too, okay? So we have some McKean model, it's a nonlinear Markov process simply with a generator given by L mu, and that we have then we assume we have a sequence of particle approximations on the state space EM with generators LM and associated Carré-Duchamp operators, okay? And now we need some properties on these that we can show convergence in the limit M to infinity, so concentration of mean field observables. So the first one is, again, obviously this consistency equation for the generator, okay? You have to generate the right dynamics. So this would give you the right expected value, essentially, okay? So obviously this has to be correct. And then second condition, you have to concentrate on the expected value. So you need some, your Carré-Duchamp operator has to go to zero. And we need that it tends to zero with a 1 over m factor in front. And times some operator, or the mean field, the empirical average of some operator. So this was the single particle Carré-Duchamp in the mean field case, but this doesn't have to be like that. So this is where we can generalize. This can be any kind of operator that is uniformly bounded, okay? And this is how we can include more particle approximations than mean field. Good, and this to leading order has to decay like this, and you can have lower order terms as well. And then another thing is, we want to look at algorithms that do selection events with more than one clone, okay? In the mean field case, I have only just produced one clone and killed one other copy of the process. You want to do more than that, but we need, for the algorithms we can describe, we need to bound this number so that the total number of clones that can change at any given time in continuous time has to be bounded by some fixed constant, okay? If it's an n to infinity, this cannot grow with m. Okay. Good. And then another obvious condition is that you initialize, obviously, your clone ensemble with the right initial conditions just independently, say, from the initial measure mu zero that you want to study your sampling from. Okay. Good. I hope these conditions are a little bit clear, and then we can get the result, namely the convergence of law of large number type result for the convergence of estimators. What do we want to estimate? We want to estimate this quantity mu t of f. This is the expectation of a test function under the bias dynamics of the process, right? Fulfills this nonlinear equation. So that's our target thing. And we also want to make t large, by the way, in the end, and really sample from u infinity. But we have a result here that gives us an upper bound uniformly in time. And this is how we can essentially use this to do Monte Carlo in practice means you make T large, but you never go to infinity anyway, right? So since you have a uniform in time estimate on the error here, this gives you essentially convergence of this for Monte Carlo purposes. So this is systematic error estimate. This is our target thing. This is the expectation of our estimator coming from the particle system. This is bounded by something of order 1 over m. And then there's a random error, which we have for all P norms larger or equal than 2. So in particular, we have the variance of the estimator for P equals 2. And this is bounded again by typical Monte Carlo type rates, which is like a 1 over square root m. And I want to stress again, this is uniform in time. And this is kind of important to make this useful. Okay, good. So this is the general result we have. One comment, maybe quick comment on this is what the statisticians told us when we talk about this result is, but your estimator is biased. So what, can you get some unbiased estimators here? Because this can be important if you cannot make M very large for some computational reason, but you can do many samples of this and then average over those, right? So you still have to, okay, so that's to approximate this expectation over M here, right? So, and then, I mean, this with bias essentially comes in because this mu t has nonlinear evolution equation. If you go back to our original question, we had these unnormalized measures mu t. They had a linear evolution equation, and for that, you can get an unbiased estimator as well, okay? And you have to, essentially, what you're sampling from is mu tm. So these are normalized, but if you think a little, it's not hard to see this, is that you can essentially generate yourself from this particle approximation an unbiased estimator of the unnormalized expectations of these functions f, okay? That's already also good enough for the physicists. For the application there. Okay, so this would be an unbiased estimator. Good, this is just a side remark. About the proof, I don't know, I want a few remarks only. I mean, this proof, essentially what we did, we adapted the method from the particle filtering literature that has, there has been something also on continuous time by Matthias Rosé, and this was well suited to be adapted to this, to our result here. So that's where we got these ideas from. So essentially, don't want to get too technical here. You have to estimate, essentially for the random error, the main part, you have to estimate this difference here, okay, in P norm. And you introduce some auxiliary time. So capital T is your target time. You introduce an auxiliary time T between zero and capital T. And the difference to T should be large, but not too large, okay? It should be large because then you can use triangle inequality here and plug in a mu tm. And now you have one part of this difference is the second part. You can simply estimate by using asymptotic stability of the original process, okay? Because this difference between small and capital T is large enough that the process initialized at some measure mu tm will simply converge to mu tf, right? This is a property of the, it's not a property of the particle system really, it's a property of the asymptotic stability property of the nonlinear evolution equation, essentially comes in there. And then here you have a difference only of mu tm's left. And here you have to use, of course, this martingale description that I introduced earlier before, right? So you know that this difference here for different times is a martingale, and you have to show that the martingale part vanishes, and then you concentrate on the deterministic evolution of this. Which, and this is given only by this integral, which is essentially the integral version of the evolution equation of mu tf. Okay, good, if you have convergence of these. So, good, so this is now standard, so you have to essentially estimate moments of martingales, and you can use the BDG inequality to do that. The only annoying thing here, which is a technical problem, but this was largely solved already by Matthias Rosé for us, is that we have nice formulas for the particular quadratic variation, but to bound the moments of the martingale, you need the quadratic variation. So you have to relate this to somehow, and we really do have chums in our path because we look at chum processes. So that is, this is the only technical aspect that we had to invest some page in here in the proof. Okay, otherwise it follows really the program I showed before. So now, I don't want to talk about this process. I want to come finally to the cloning algorithm. How does this fit into this picture? Okay, so this is again the mean field approximation I already explained. So you have the original dynamics called mutation. You clone one particle at a time, and with another rate, you have an independent process that kills particles and replaces them with a uniformly chosen copy. For the cloning, they try to be more efficient. So essentially, you have killing is the same as before, but the cloning. And essentially, they want to choose their constant in the process that they don't do any killing, but only cloning. I will come to that. So they only do cloning and mutation at the same time. So they say, whenever I have a mutation event, I also clone. And I have to clone. So I'm essentially cloning with the wrong rate here. Okay. So I have to compensate for this by varying the number of clones I produce. Okay. So instead of producing always only one clone with the right rate, I produce a random number of clones with the wrong rate so that the expected number of clones I produce per unit of time is correct. Okay, so that's the main idea. So, good. So let's see how this works. So if you want to formalize this or write this down as a generator, it looks a little bit more tedious. So here you have the mutation dynamics that are now combined events. So they happen with the mutation rate. And this is the rate to move clone I from state XI to state Y. This will happen, but before that, for the whole system given by the vector x, you pick a set A of other copies that you kill and replace them with state xi. Okay, so you make a clone thing like this. Before you mutate, then you mutate to the new state y. Okay, and then you have some killing dynamics still in the loop here, but you don't change that. The way to get rid of killing is simply to pick this constant c. Let me not get this wrong. Small enough. If I make this very small, so this v is a bounding continuous function. I make this smaller than the smallest value of v, then this is always zero. So I can turn off killing anyway. Okay, and then I only do a mutation and clone. Good. So that's the idea of this cloning algorithm. And the problem was when the physicists write this down, they didn't write down generators. Obviously, they write this down in an algorithmic way, and they didn't know how to show that this actually converges what they are doing. It was obviously working, but there was this feeling in the community that, okay, it would be good to have a proof of conversion. This was also one of the main motivations for us to write this formally down and actually show convergence. Okay, good. So how do you pick this cloning distribution now? Obviously, so all the clones are equally important. So the set A shouldn't depend on any indices in particular. So it's only the size of the set A, and you pick them uniformly. Okay, so that makes it simpler already. So this pi x of A is just a pi x of the size of A. So it's a function. It's a probability distribution depending on the state x that you want to clone. How many copies do you produce? Number n, right? And of course, it has to be chosen that the total number of clones produced per time has the right rate, because we're sampling the clone event with the wrong rate, which was this W, essentially the total exit rate of state X. We have to correct that by choosing the average number of clones produced in every event by this ratio. Okay? Maybe you don't follow exactly, but this is really, it's very clear to see that this is this has to be the expected value of this distribution. And then the second quantity you can be interested in is the second moment of this distribution. I mean, this distribution is free to choose. It just has to have the right mean, okay? And there's no condition. Q has to be bounded, but there's no condition on Q a priori. But we will see that it's a good idea to choose the distribution in a way that this second moment is as small as possible, because now we can do some analysis on how big are the fluctuations for this cloning algorithm, okay? So first thing is, if you look at the generator for the cloning algorithm and you apply this to a mean field test function, it actually, you can just make some transformations here, which is just switch some sums around, and you see it has exactly the same, the generator is the same as the generator of the mean field model acting on the same test function. So for mean field test functions, they generate the same deterministic dynamics, so which is good. Okay, so the cloning algorithm really does the same thing as a mean field model, just in a different way. And the difference between these two algorithms, of course, you see on the level of the Carré-Duchamp operators, and the fluctuations are different, and you see this on the level of this operator. So you have to compute this operator, and that was one of the main exercises to understand. So the cloning algorithm compute the Carré-Duchamp operator for this thing. Okay, good, and we have to show that it is of the form 1 over m, so it tends to zero with this rate, times the empiric, the expectation of some operator that is bounded. So that is what we have to show in order to apply our general result to the cloning algorithm. And it works. It's a bit of a tedious computation, but you see what you get for this operator here is actually the original single particle Carré-Duchamp, which is good. So this, but not exactly that. You get, this would be for the mean field model, this would be the only term, right? But now we get a correction because of this cloning algorithm, and we see that this correction is proportional to the second minus the first moment, essentially, times something quadratic, which has a sign. So here you have something, and the second moment is always bigger than the first moment. So this term has a sign. It's a leading order correction. And the smaller you can make this correction, the better, because this is a general wisdom. The smaller your Carré-Duchamp, the smaller the selection, total selection you introduce, the better your estimator. Okay, this is something we try to show in general with this asymptotic variance result that I simply didn't show you, but we failed. So I don't want to say anything more. But there's a general idea that the smaller this is, the better, right? So this is, nobody doubts that really, but it's hard to really make this rigorous in this setting. Okay, Good. So this is why it is a good idea to choose a distribution that has the right mean, but a small, this, keep the second moment as small as possible. So what you do, I mean, it's a distribution over integers. You simply pick the two nearest integers to the mean with the right probabilities, okay? That has the smallest second moment that you have the right mean. The mean may not be an integer, right? So it's that's the best thing you can do. And somehow, whatever, surprisingly or luckily, this is exactly what the physicists did. They had no idea about this, but they used this immediately because it's also somehow the simplest thing you can do. But in a sense, it was also an optimal choice. Good. Where they did not use an optimal choice in retrospect, which we can see from our analysis now, is by the choice of the original single particle dynamics, because they were basing this implicitly on this McKean model with this transition rate. Okay, and I've already talked to you before a little bit about it. This would be a better single particle model. Okay, and but the way they constructed the cloning algorithm, we simply would never get to this one. So this, it was kind of, they didn't know about McKean, but they arrived at this by a different route, and it's essentially this model. But if you can make an algorithm based on this model, it may be better. And why? Because again, this is the folklore. You want to compute the total selection rate in a state X. Okay, this is the new additional dynamics you introduce to bias your ensemble, and you want to make this as small as possible. Okay, so in the first, if you have this choice of rates, what is the optimal choice of the constant C that your total selection rate is small? You can do a small computation. It's simply given by this sum of first moments of the potential difference with C. So if you pick the median of the potential essentially as your constant, then you can minimize this as a function of C essentially. Good. And you can also see that the second choice, more efficient rate, is always the total selection rate is simply given by this expression. It's always smaller than this one, even if for optimal choice of C. Okay. So this is how you can quantify that this is in a sense better. And the third one, which is very hard to implement, this one is yet better, but not much. And it's so much more, how much harder to implement it, that it wasn't worth looking into it for our purpose, at least. Okay. Yes, let me, because I don't want to, when should I finish? I still have 5 minutes or so?
Yes, you have 5 minutes.
Okay, very, very good. So let me skip some things. Here I explain in detail how you apply this now to interacting particle systems where you want to measure current large deviations, okay? And I think we can skip this, and I show you some particular application here, okay? So we look at a very simple, our original process now, this mutation dynamics is now given by an interacting particle system, okay? I'm no longer talking about ensembles, but I'm talking about one process, which is now a particle system. Going back to the original motivation I had in the beginning, this is now on a one-dimensional lattice, a nearest neighbor particle system where you jump with a rate from set to set plus one that depends on the number of particles on the departure and target side only, and you have some asymmetry parameter here, P and Q, right? So you can jump to set plus one or to set minus one. Okay, so I want to use this particular example now as the original dynamics. And so this is a continuous time jump process, obviously on the state space. So we need to have a fixed lattice L that we can apply our result here. And so finally, yeah. For if you have finite state, so if you fix a number of particles here, for example, and you have a periodic boundary condition, so you have a finite state Markov chain, then due to some very generic contraction argument, it's the first reference I know about this, you have actually a large deviation principle for AT. So this is, I didn't explain AT, so this was not very good. Let me say AT is an observable, a dynamic observable, this one. So you want to essentially measure, say AT counts the current in the system across a certain bond. Okay, let's make it simple, okay, for this particular application. So this is an observable that depends on the path of the process up to time T. Okay, and we fix the lattice, but we want to make T large. T is our parameter that gets large, and we want to establish a large deviation principle for this sequence AT, okay, when T gets large. Good. And this exists, I mean, for finite state continuous time Markov chains simply due to a contraction argument, but you don't get a very explicit rate function from it all. So you still have to, so you know you have an LEP, but you you still have to kind of numerically approximate your rate function if you want to, from this simulation, right? So this is essentially why the physicists invented this algorithm. And how do you numerically approximate the rate function? Essentially, this is no way, but I thought I can skip this, and now I'm gonna, here. It's essentially given by this principal eigenvalue of the perturbed generator. Okay, I cannot explain in detail now why this is the case. And this you can find from our Monte Carlo scheme in the particle system now simply by looking at the expectation of the potential V. Okay, good. So this is what we're after. And so we here I'm just summarizing some of the conditions we had before. If we have certain simple conditions on the rates of this particle system, this is for example fulfilled for the exclusion process, for zero range process, or inclusion process. So there's a whole class of particle systems that has this nice property, so that I don't want to say anything more about it. So this P plus Q is one. Then you have the algorithms that I talked about, they simplify quite substantially. You can implement them pretty easily. I don't want to go into any details. So we did this for the inclusion process in some numerical work with Andrea Pizzo-Ferrato. So just short reminder. So this is essentially an exclusion model where you replace the one minus eta x plus one, you replace it with a plus, and then you introduce another parameter d here. Okay. So you can have as many particles as you want on a certain site, and the more particles you have on your target site, the higher the rate is to jump there. So they attract each other rather than exclude each other. Good. And if you turn on this simulations for this inclusion process, so we were running the cloning algorithm as invented by the physicists with constant zero, so the non-optimal constant. And then we were running this second choice of McKean model with a simple mean field approximation. So it's in a sense a much simpler system to implement. And we see that what we do here is we have a control parameter k. So the potential we put on the diagonal of the operator is some exponential in k. Okay, so you bias every single jump in your process with e to the k. And then you get a leading order eigenvalue that you get from this simply sampling mu infinity of V, right? And this is the same thing as the scale cumulant generating function of your large deviation problem. I don't have time to explain this, but there's a direct way to simulate the Legendre transform of the large deviation rate function, essentially, right? And this is how you use this algorithm. So you fix this control parameter k, and you want to estimate the leading order eigenvalue of your perturbed operator. And you see that this cloning algorithm is that both doing a pretty good job, but the error bars in the cloning algorithm are much bigger than in the simpler algorithm based on this different single particle dynamics. Okay, so, and here's some explanation for this. So we look at the total selection rate that we introduce in the system that you want to keep as small as possible. This is for the cloning algorithm. If you choose an optimal constant for the cloning algorithm, you're almost as good as this algorithm number two that we use. And so this is for two different control parameters. I don't want to really start. So if you pick the right constant in cloning, the message is you can be almost as good as this mean field model. But if whenever you can implement this simpler mean field model, which is non-cloning, I think you're doing better than cloning. So that was a little bit of, it's not really, okay, that was part of the result, practical application of our result. Okay, good. Let me not comment on this. I ran out of time, so I'm just finishing with this slide and I don't say anything about it. Okay, thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Stefan. I think we can thank the speaker.
Thanks, yeah.
And well, let's open for questions. Are there questions? So, well, I have many questions. So,
okay.
Let me try to see if I understood. So let's say that you are back in your TASAP and you want to simulate some current, which is not the typical current of your...
Yeah.
No, if I understood, so you, what you're proposing is some algorithm which will generate this current, which is the one which you want to see. But
yes, I didn't explain you how this works. This is maybe the problem. So
and what I understand is, how do you know? Well, because there is one way in which you perturb your system, which has the smallest cost. And this is given by, let's say, the large deviations.
Yeah.
And so why do you know that the one you're simulating is the one which has...
You don't. Okay. What you do is you perturb with the control parameter K in a way like this. So if you jump, you do a particular jump in your process. And for example, if this is a jump across the bond where you measure a current, then you can... you give this a positive weight with K positive. You give this a positive weight here. Okay, so this is how you essentially you tilt the generator like this. Okay, so whenever you jump, for every jump you give a weight like this, and you can also give an, a general also condition on local times if you want to. So this would be an explicit diagonal part. If you stay in a particular state for a time, then you gain. But maybe if you only look at jumps, you can forget this part. You only have this G, H is zero. And then you can always, also this part, you can rewrite it in terms of a generator of a Markov process that is conservative. This has now already some, some bias on it. So some important sampling is already happening here, okay? Mm-hmm. Because this conservative generator now somehow depends on K. But what you do here, you introduce something on the off diagonal when you do something with the jump, you bias the jump with the control parameter K, but you can move this back onto the diagonal, okay? So you can always write it in terms of this Feynman cuts type thing, and then. You're right. I mean, I don't know what will be the actual typical current I see now under this perturbation, but I have essentially perturbed my process with a parameter K, and this is why I'm not directly simulating the large variation rate function. I simulate the Legendre transform of it, namely the scale cumulant generating function I can get from this, right? And then you have to Legendre transform, and then you get your rate function, but you don't have direct access to say I want to bias my system on seeing a particular current. You cannot do that. You have a control parameter, you have to do the full thing. And then from a function of the control parameter, you can go back to this. And then obviously you have this Legendre duality. So once you have done this, you know what is the right K to the A. Okay.
So
but a priori you don't know this connection. You only know it after you know your generating function at least.
I see. So you need the large deviation result to tell you what are the perturbation you need to impose. You impose your perturbation, you simulate with your algorithm, then you get currents, and then you'll see, for a fixed current, which is the one which minimize.
Yes, but then it's also very important, interesting question of yours, yes. So how do you now see a typical trajectory of the process? Because this is not so easy here in this. Because this is, I have no good picture for that here now, but this is an evolutionary tree in a sense, right? A lot of these realizations are going to be killed at a later time, so they don't play any role. So what you have to do is to actually see a trajectory typical under the large deviation event. You go until your last time, you pick one of these realizations and you follow back the evolutionary tree of this guy. Because this will jump between realizations of your actual clones. If you follow back a single clone, you don't see the right dynamics, because then you essentially see the McKean dynamics, which have been changed, right? This is a nonlinear dynamics. You don't want to see this. You want to see the large deviation realization. And there you have to follow back the dynamics So for example, here, whatever, wait, I came here, so I'm going back here maybe, and then I go back here, right? This is the dynamics you have to then plot. So it's not easy. You cannot immediately produce a single trajectory that has the right bias, right? You have to store all your trajectories and then go back in time. That's another, of course, computational problem if you're really interested in long trajectories. But to produce an illustration, it's you can do that. But okay, not on a large scale. Yeah, you need a lot of memory.
And can you use that in order, let's say, if you take a diffusion with a potential field which has, let's say, two wells, and you want to see which is the trajectory which brings you from one well to the other one, the one which causes
instability. I think for this, there are some works by Touchette who applied this to some simple test problems. And I'm not sure if this was exactly, I think this must be one of them. I mean, you obviously you want to introduce some bias towards the well. And okay, I'm not aware of any particular stuff, but it seems to me like this is this should be a typical thing you can use this for. Yeah. But right, I'm not sure. I mean, there's a lot of many other, I mean, you have transition path sampling. So there's a lot of other methods you can use, right? I'm not saying if you're interested in metastability and metastable transition path, very good question. I'm not sure if this method will be really very efficient then. I have never thought of it. It's a good question, actually. So, yeah.
Fine. And last question. So how do you choose among all these possible, when you say efficiency or... So how you choose among these all different algorithms?
Yes, so our hope was you get a nice formula for the asymptotic variance of your estimator, right? It's always in statistics, you have this, I want to estimate this expectation of some test function f at some time t, and then I have my estimator mu t m, and this has a variance. And if the goodness of the estimator is you want to minimize the variance. And if we have... We got stuck here. We didn't get any useful formula and also under no good conditions. So that is really just a useless result in a sense. But ideally you want to minimize the asymptotic variance. And as I said before, there is a general understanding that for this particular evolutionary algorithms, you typically do this by minimizing the total selection rate of additional dynamics that you introduce in your process. And this, we were not able to show any of this rigorously, unfortunately, but this is what you have to do. And this has, again, this has two aspects to it, right? You first have to choose a particle approximation of the nonlinear dynamics, and you have to choose your nonlinear dynamics. And here if we compare them all together, then it turned out for this particular scenario that this second choice was better than the first one, okay? But So we don't really have a fully systematic understanding of what is the best thing here, but at least you have some idea how to compare two things if you have two ideas. So,
all right. Well, thank you. Are there other questions? Okay, so if no more questions, let's thank Stefan again. Thank you very much, Stefan.
Hey, thanks a lot. Yeah, thank you.
Bye, Stefan.
Thank you. Yep. Just remind you that while this is the last talk of the year, so we start next year on January the 5th with Makiko Sazada at the same time. So see you there. Bye-bye.
Okay. Thanks. Bye. Thanks a lot.